After Jesus died and was resurrected, he appeared to the disciples before ascending to heaven. He gave many proofs, a path, and a promise. He soon would be gone, but they would not be forgotten. A voice in the wilderness, John baptized with water. Jesus said, "Wait in Jerusalem for a gift from the Father. The Holy Spirit will come, poured out like a flood, new baptism, fresh anointing, and infinite power." Gathered together in upper room, lives suspended, they had emptied themselves, full surrender, full submission, hidden from the world about, with hearts laid bare to God above, waiting, unknowing, unfettered, yes, uncertain.
For the Spirit of the Lord is here. The evidence is all around that the Spirit of the Lord is here. The atmosphere is changing now. For the Spirit of the Lord. Evidence is all around that the Spirit of the Lord is here, overflowing this place. Fill our hearts with your love. Your love surrounds us. You're the reason we came.
And as they prayed, a sound, overwhelming, unexpected, intense, filled the room where they waited. Were they ready for this? Something like fire came down from above, a flame that divided, rested on everyone. It purified heart, soul, mind, and purpose. They spoke in languages not known to them. The crowd heard the gospel in each native tongue. Some 3,000 souls found salvation that day. Divine revelation, entire sanctification. The Holy Spirit had come.
The atmosphere is changing now. For the Spirit of the Lord is here. The evidence is all around. Let the Spirit of the
stand with us this morning.
Overflowing this place, fill our hearts with your love surrounds us. You're the reason we came to encounter your love, your
God, fall fresh on us. We need your presence. Your kingdom come. Your will be done here as it is in heaven. Spirit of God, fall in a new way on us today. We long to experience your presence in our hearts. Your kingdom come now. done here just as it is in heaven. Spirit of God, flood and fill, consume and overwhelm this place. We are desperate in need of your presence. Your kingdom come, right here, right now. Your will be done in this place, at this time, that your name would be glorified, just as it is in heaven.
Amen. You may be seated.
Well, good morning. So good to see you all. Hey, if you're here with us today, we believe wholeheartedly that God has something incredible he wants to do for each of us on this Pentecost Sunday. We've already begun to celebrate that, so we're going to continue to celebrate that today. But I have a few announcements for us. When you came in this morning, hopefully you received a bulletin. In that bulletin is a connection card. If you're a guest with us today, we would love to get to know you a little bit. So please fill that out with as much info as you're comfortable with. If you're a regular, you hear us say this every single week, but we would love to know that you're with us today. We would also, most importantly, love to pray with you. So please mark that on your card, and there are boxes at the back of the sanctuary that you can drop that connection card in. Hey, a lot of fun things happening, but some really cool stuff. Our food pantry is giving away more food and helping more families than they ever have before, which is exciting. We can celebrate that, right? But that comes with some need. So they're in need of meat right now. So if you can check the bulletin for details, if you could help donate to that, that would be wonderful. We want to continue to serve those in our community. Also, we have a missions team that is going to be going to help do some renovations at Water's Edge at our district campground. If you'd like to help, you can mark that on that connection card I mentioned. You can check the bulletin. You can contact the church office, or you can talk to Pastor Scott about that. And lastly, we want to thank you for continuing to be generous. You know, God's people are always so generous, and so much of the ministry that happens here is because of your generosity. So as you give today, there are offering boxes in the back. You're also welcome to give online, or you can also mail in your offering. So I'm going to pray for our giving, and then we're going to continue with a couple other things. So let's pray together. Lord, thank you so much for this day. Thank you for the opportunity to worship you on this Pentecost Sunday. I just pray that you would continue to be with our giving, that we would continue to use it to your will. We love you. In your name, amen. All right, I'm going to invite some graduates up. This is my least favorite Sunday of the year. Real motley crew today. We're going to honor four graduates today. Two of them are here in person. So the first one is Madeline Condon. She is graduating from Davison and Millington High School. She is going to Saginaw Valley State University to study nursing. And she has been around for a very long time. She's been in our dinner theaters. She's gone to NYC, to camp, to retreat, and on mission trips. And it's just been an incredible young lady to have in our group. And we wish she could be here with us today, but unfortunately she couldn't be. So we just want to honor her. Can we give her a round of applause? Oh, I'm not going to make it through this. All right. Next up is Mr. Ryan Laidler. That's the blonde. He's the son of Dan and Dawn Laidler. He is graduating from Lapeer High School. Go Lapeer. He is heading to Central Michigan University. You really didn't respond to that well. All right. He's heading to Central Michigan University to study music education. Fire up chips. He has been here forever. Yep. He participated in kids' musicals, dinner theaters. You've been to NYC. You've gone to camp, retreats, mission trips. You've played in the praise band. You've helped with Upwards. You've served at Feed My Starving Children. Is there anything you haven't done around here? You've helped usher. You haven't preached yet? All right, we can work on that. Hey, some traits that were written on the questionnaire we sent out. Some positive traits, I think, is that he is open, personable, comical, and handsome. Did your mother write that? so she did write it. Okay, that's fair. His favorite youth group memory, this involves both of you actually, his favorite youth group memory, we went to Nazarene Youth Conference in Phoenix, Arizona a couple years ago and had a great time. I got a phone call at about midnight one night because these gentlemen had broken a toilet. Like broken a toilet seat in half. It was great. So and we're really, really worried they were going to get sent home. I said, no, we just call maintenance. Anyways. So Ryan, it has been such a joy. Oh, I'm not going to make it through this. It's been such a joy to have you, you know, both of you. But it's been so great to have you in our group. It's just to see you grow so much. I'm just so excited for what God has next for you. Round of applause for Ryan. Next up is, easy. Next up is Matthew Owen. This is Matthew. Matthew is the son of Steve and Sandy Owen. He was homeschooled, spent the last year at Millington High School, and is heading to Mott, Go Bears, in the fall to study nursing. Matthew has helped with our dinner theater. He's worked with Miss Joy. He's helped with Upwards. And you've been around quite a while as well, you know, your whole life. Some words to describe Matthew are funny, hardworking, motivated, godly, honest, and amazing. Did your mom write those? Yeah, she did. All right. Fair. His favorite youth group memory is NYC. It was your first time on a plane and first time seeing the Grand Canyon, which was incredible. Yeah. Matthew, man, I am just... I love you so much, dude. I'm just so excited for what God has next and to see you grow and to get to see you just flourish in your nursing career. I'm just so excited to watch that. So, and lastly, you'll see it. Yeah, a round of applause for Matthew, please. And lastly, Michael Varon, who's the son of Allison Gerard, is graduating from Bentley. Let's give him a round of applause also. So at this time, I'm going to invite Pastor Allen up to come and pray with our graduates here and pray for our graduates who couldn't be with us today.
Oh, my goodness. Seeing those pictures of you guys as little tykes. And yeah, there is that whole what happened. But there's also the I am so excited to see fine young men who we are so proud of and so thrilled to see whom you have become. And excited about who you are going to continue to become. So it is my privilege to be able to pray with you. Let's pray together. God, thank you for each of our graduates, those who are with us and those who are not. Lord, of course, we pray for Madeline and the stress in her family this week and the loss of her mom, and we pray for your blessing on all of them. And thank you so much here today for these two men who are in your house, who are seeking to follow your direction for their lives today and in the days to come. I pray that that would be the most true truth in everything that they are and that they do. Bless them with yourself. Guide each step of their lives. Surround them with grace, strength, and courage. Bless them in all of their pursuits and endeavors in these days, we pray, in the passionate, powerful name of Jesus. Amen. God bless you guys.
And hey, one more thing that we typically do. If in the past year you have graduated with a bachelor's or a master's and you're here, would you stand just so we can honor you as well? Nobody. Perfect. Pastor Jerry?
Church, the giving of the Holy Spirit that we celebrate today was a powerful moment in history. That same power that brought God to earth as a baby, that guided everything Christ did while he walked among us, and that raised Jesus from the dead, that was given to us. The transformation that took place in the disciples and the impact of their ministry is available to us as well. Your life can be transformed. Your life can impact others in miraculous ways, but only if you seek and submit to that same Holy Spirit. So as we continue to worship and recount the story of Christ in the early church, would you take a little time for self-examination? Are you allowing the Holy Spirit to use you? Are you impacting those around you in powerful ways? Are you listening for the guidance and direction the Holy Spirit gives? Are you purposefully slowing down so that you can even hear Him? The power that did incredible things that we read about in the Bible is fully available to us as well. And if we only seek, listen, and obey. Pray with me. Father, open our eyes in the moments we have left together this morning. Clear our minds of distractions. Open our hearts to your prompting. Open our ears to your voice and embolden our spirit to respond. Spirit, lead us as we pray. Amen.
In the darkness we were waiting, without hope, without light. Till from heaven you came running, there was mercy in your eyes. To fulfill the law and prophets, to a virgin came the word. From a throne of endless glory, to a cradle in the dirt.
Would you stand and sing, praise the Father?
Praise the Father, praise the Son, praise the Spirit, three in one. God of glory, majesty, praise forever to the King of Kings. To reveal the kingdom coming, to reconcile the lost, to redeem the whole creation, you did not despise the cross. For even in your suffering, you saw to the other side, knowing this was our salvation, Jesus, for our sake you died. Christ. This is my worship. This is my offering. In every moment, I withhold nothing. I'm learning to trust you, even when I can't see it. And even in suffering, I have to believe it. So if you say it's wrong, then I'll say no. If you say release, I'm letting go. If you're in it with me, I'll begin. When you say to jump, I'm diving in. If you say be still, then I will wait. If you say to trust, I will obey. I don't want to follow my own way. I'm done chasing feelings. Spirit, lead me. It felt like a burden, but once I could grasp it, you took me further, further than I was asking. And simply to see you is worth it all. My life is an altar. Let your fire fall. If you say it's wrong, then I'll say no. If you say release, I'm letting go. If you're in it with me, I'll begin. When you say to jump, I'm diving in. If you say be still, then I will wait. If you say to trust, I will obey. Teach me how to follow in your ways. I'm not chasing feelings. Spirit,
Spirit, lead me. Lord Jesus, we're glad today. Lord Jesus, we're glad today that you want to lead us by your Spirit. Sometimes it's waiting. Sometimes it's diving in. But it all needs to come back to your Spirit. We don't want to chase feelings, which means just kind of going by our feelings. They need to also be confirmed by the truth of the Scriptures and by what you've taught us about your ways. We thank you, Father, that you will continue to lead us and you will continue to guide us. And we pray that this would be true for our church and for every single person in the sound of my voice in our everyday living throughout this coming week. We want to thank you for the many, many blessings that you've brought to us, and we want to thank you for these fine graduates, those who are here and those who could not be here, as Pastor Allen has already prayed. We want to thank you, Father, for Pentecost, for sending the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit, we pray that you would make yourself especially keen and obvious to us in our lives today. Lord, I pray that you be with special requests. We want to think of those in our church who have lost loved ones. We want to think this morning, Father, of our special Joy Berger and Bruce and family and the loss of her mother this past week. We just pray for continuing strength and comfort that can come only from you. We pray, Father, that you would be with Mark Purcell and his family and the loss of his brother Richard last weekend. We pray that you would work there. And Lord, continue to be with the Ewing family and the loss of Joe and the loss for many of us. We just pray that your continued grace and strength would be for that family. And we pray too, Lord, for the Congdon family, for Crystal Work, and for everyone involved in that family, all of the Hopkins, Lord, and the loss of Tracy late Friday night. We just pray that as the funerals this week, that your special grace and comfort would be upon them. We pray for those who are sick among us, Lord. Today we commit to you mental, physical, and all things in between that we just need to give to you. We believe that you are a miracle-working, prayer-answering God. And we pray for healing for many, and they are on our list. Make us mindful of those for whom we need to pray. Be with our nation. We pray that you would bless all of our leadership. We pray that you bless our world today, and that we pray for peace in Ukraine. We continue to pray, Lord, for the rest of this service, that you'd be with our pastor as he leads us in opening up the Scriptures. Holy Spirit, you who inspired the Scriptures, now make the application to us as we open our hearts to you. I bless this congregation here present and online in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit of God. Amen and amen.
Well, grab your Bibles with me if you would like and turn with me to Acts chapter 2. Acts chapter 2. You are looking good today. Give yourselves a round of applause today. Wow. Thank you, ma'am, very much. I see a lot of orange here today. You may or may not be able to tell that my shirt is mostly orange. I'm in solidarity with the Feed My Starving Children gang. Snarky comments aside, I'm excited about what God is doing through our church, and really, really excited about every opportunity that we have to make a difference in our world. And God bless you all for all that you are doing. Friday night, we had our prayer vigil. It was amazing. Jan and I started and ended the prayer vigil. This is Pentecost weekend. So we started out at the fire pit where there was a fire that was maintained throughout the entire prayer vigil. And it was amazing. And it started at 4 And I don't know if you remember Friday evening at 4 o'clock, but at 4 o'clock, the wind was really blowing, and there were a lot of trees out there, and the sound of the wind and the trees was just incredible and powerful. And then here we are seated around the fire pit praying, and then some of us later began to talk about how every one of us were impacted by the sound of the rushing mighty wind and the fire as it was blowing the fire around, and we were just reminded. It just made Pentecost suddenly come alive and feel so very real for us in those moments. So thank you, Spiritual Life Committee, for envisioning and making all of this happen with this prayer vigil, because we do serve a miracle-working, prayer-answering God, and I'm excited to hear over the days and weeks and months and years to come about how God is hearing and answering those prayers. When the resurrected Jesus was about to ascend into heaven, he told his disciples in Acts chapter 1, "Don't leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift that my Father promised, which you've heard me speak about. For John baptized with water, but in a few days you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit." Today is the anniversary of Pentecost. It's Pentecost Sunday, 50 days after Easter. Today is the day the Holy Spirit came on the church. And Jesus said to us, to all of us, wait, seek, pursue, pray, invite the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Expect for the Holy Spirit to do this in your lives. Graduates, today, we are so excited for you. We honor you. We celebrate your accomplishment. Help me say congratulations one more time, would you please, to the graduates? I want to encourage you, graduates. I remember graduating from high school. It was such an incredible, special moment, and it is. Through hard work and mostly just through sheer endurance, you have accomplished this amazing milestone that many, many people in our world still don't accomplish, never achieve. High school graduation is really important for a lot of reasons, isn't it? It is a benchmark, a milestone. It's a turning point in our lives. For all of us, in many ways, it's kind of a rite of passage. It is that step where we all acknowledge, everybody except mothers acknowledge, that we go from childhood to adulthood. And I don't know if moms ever acknowledge that. And that's okay, right? But it's one of those places where we suddenly look at ourselves in the mirror and we say, I am not there anymore. I am here. And it's so exciting. And it means new choices and new responsibilities. It means an incredible vista of new opportunities. And we are so excited for each of you. But let me encourage you, and not just graduates, but all of us. Let me encourage you. As you step forward, listen to the voice of the Holy Spirit. Listen and look for Jesus. Pursue the Holy Spirit. As you consider your own spiritual journey, choose Jesus. Seek the Holy Spirit. Graduates, you've grown up in a world that has been handed to you that is increasingly, people all around us are increasingly uncertain about who God is or how important it is to follow Him. In my own journey, I grew up going to church, and yet I got really serious about following Jesus when I was pretty young. And as I was following Jesus, I was passionate about following Jesus. And yet, as a committed follower of Jesus, I began to recognize and realize that there had to be something more, that there was something more that I needed in my own spiritual journey. If I am going to actually live what I say I believe, I realized eventually that I needed the Holy Spirit in my life. And I have discovered at every pivotal event in my life since then, I really, really, really need the person and the power of the Holy Spirit in my life. Jesus said that we need the Holy Spirit in our lives to help us to be in the world, but not of the world. Jesus wants every one of us as followers of His to live in this world. We don't really have a choice. We live in this world that is given to us, this world that doesn't necessarily acknowledge Him or follow Him in so many different ways. This world that is what it is. And Jesus wants us to live and passionately make a difference in this world, to be lights in the darkness, but He wants for us as we live in this world to be qualitatively different than everyone around us. We need Jesus' forgiveness. Everybody on this planet needs Jesus' forgiveness that is offered to us, but we also need more. God loves you so much that He sent His only Son to die so that your sins could be forgiven and your eternal destiny could be impacted, but He loves you too much to leave you there alone. And so on Pentecost, He sent His Holy Spirit to come and do something powerful. We need the power of the Holy Spirit to change our hearts, to change our motives, to change our thoughts, to change our actions. You know, when God starts to really radically transform my heart, it changes the way I think, which changes the way I speak and the way I act. It changes everything. Every one of us needs a personal Pentecost. Our world... That is a really good place to say amen. Thank you, Jan. Take your cues from Pastor Jan. if you aren't sure, that's a great place. Our world needs Jesus. Would you agree? That one's a really easy yes. Won't cost you anything, okay? Our world needs Jesus. That's good. Thank you. Jan didn't even have to start that. Stop that. Okay. I promise I'll stop having fun in just a minute. The needs around us are incredible. What a beautiful day to look and to see all these orange t-shirts. The needs of the poor are so incredible. The needs of the oppressed are so overwhelming. So many people around us just are driven by frustration and hopelessness and in our world, most people would say, yes, I believe in God. But they live, many, many, many people live as if there is no God. And that's a struggle. But it isn't new. Jesus was born into a world in the same condition that was struggling under suffering and corruption and violence. And Jesus said, I have come to bring life, to bring hope. He said, I am the hope. He came to offer us a better way. Jesus said, here's the better way. Take up your cross and follow me. Wait a minute, Jesus, what does that look like? And then he took up his cross and he died for us. But then God raised him to life. And Easter Sunday evening, Jesus, the resurrected Jesus, breathed on his disciples. And John says in John 20:22 that when he breathed on them, he said, receive the Holy Spirit. Now, I don't want to overcomplicate this. I want to make this really, really, really simple. And so I want to walk through something here with you. Watch this. Jesus said, receive the Holy Spirit. See, what happens is when I become a Christian, when I become a follower of Jesus, I receive Jesus' Spirit. When you invite Jesus into your heart, you receive Jesus' Spirit, the Spirit of Christ. Paul said it this way in Romans 8, if anyone does not have the Spirit of Christ, they do not belong to Christ. If you are a follower of Jesus, you have the Spirit of Christ. So what's so big, you know, what's the big deal about Pentecost? Jesus breathed his Spirit onto his disciples, and then he spent the next 40 days after Easter showing and telling them that even though he had died, he was alive. When you invite Jesus into your heart, he comes in. That's his Spirit. But Jesus said, my work is not finished. I want to do more. Jesus wants us to have more. This cough drop shouldn't be that hard to open. In Acts 1:4, Jesus said, wait. My Father promised you a gift. Wait and seek the gift. Jesus said, you have me, you have my spirit, but you need more. Now, I've heard it characterized 100 different ways. One of them is very simple. When I am born again, I get all of the Spirit. But when I am filled with the Spirit, when I'm entirely sanctified, the Spirit gets all of me. That's one way to picture it. Jesus said, God has a gift for you. Jesus said, God wants you to have so much more of my Spirit than you can possibly imagine yet. You can be filled. And he said, you need to be filled with my Spirit. You need to be filled with the Holy Spirit. Jesus was so excited for his disciples to receive the gift of his Spirit. Now think about that. Jesus is excited to give you a gift. We don't want to miss that. Jesus has a gift for us. Don't you like gifts? I love gifts. Jesus has a gift. Don't hear me asking for gifts. Jesus has a gift. Jesus has a gift for us. We need the Holy Spirit. We need the gift of the Holy Spirit. We need the fullness of the Holy Spirit because of who he is and because of what he does in our lives. The Holy Spirit is the Spirit of Christ. The Holy Spirit is the Spirit of God the Father. We serve one God. Everybody say one God. One God in three persons, Father, Son, and Spirit, the Trinity. God is one. And when God the Holy Spirit comes and fills a Christian, he does at least three amazing, powerful things. And those three actions are symbolized on the day of Pentecost by the wind, the fire, the speaking in tongues. And I want us to look at that together here really quickly. And as we do, I want to start by reading the story of Pentecost. Acts chapter 2, verse 1. When the day of Pentecost came, they, the 120, the early disciples, were all together in one place. Suddenly, a sound like a blowing of a violent wind came from heaven and filled the whole house where they were sitting. And they saw what seemed to be tongues of fire that separated and came to rest on each one of them. Each one of them. God the Holy Spirit wants to come on each one of us. Before it had just been on the prophets and the leaders. Now the Holy Spirit is given to each one of us. All of them, each of them, all of them were filled with the Holy Spirit. It's each of us and all of us. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit enabled them. God the Holy Spirit comes. What does he do? Well, he fills us with himself. He fills Christians with himself. If you are a Christian, you have the Spirit of Christ in you. But the Holy Spirit wants to fill you with himself. Now, when I think about the Holy Spirit, I think about all the different stories in the Bible, and I associate the Holy Spirit with so many things. One of the stories, you remember the story of Elijah. Elijah was the great prophet of God. God used him. He called down fire from heaven. He did so many amazing things. But at a pivotal point in his life, when he was really going through a hard, hard time, Elijah went to connect with God. He went to the mountain in order to meet with God. And God said, Elijah, what are you doing here? They had this amazing conversation. But as the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of God was there to meet with Elijah. First, there were all these powerful things that occurred. Remember, there was a wind that blew the mountain and fire. And there were all these tremendous things. And God wasn't in any of those tremendous things. And there was a still small voice, a whisper. And Elijah recognized it as the voice of God. Now here in Acts chapter 2, there's the sound of a blowing, violent wind. I grew up in Oklahoma.
Wind is normal in Oklahoma. It's just, you know, if there's not a 30-mile-an-hour wind, it's just a very, very calm day. Wind, violent wind is normal. Tornadoes were regular occurrence. So that is something that I can really, really relate to. But what the Bible teaches is that God can come very, very quietly, or that God can come really, really loud, or anything in between. God comes, the Spirit of God comes in the way that God chooses to come on us and on you. In fact, I would go so far as to say the Spirit of God comes in the way that you need for Him to come. Because He's God, and He loves you, and He knows you, and He knows exactly how you need to encounter Him and experience Him in your life. And for some people, that's a really big thing. And for others, it's a very quiet thing. Now, notice something amazing. The word for wind in verse 2, the word there for wind, it's an amazing word. There is a word that's used in the Old Testament, it's written in Hebrew. In the New Testament, it's written in Greek. And there's a word that in each of those languages it's incredible that they're so similar. And each of those words means one word, and it means either wind or breath or spirit. The Hebrew word and the Greek word. And they're both used a lot in the Bible. When I am filled with the Spirit of God, I am filled with the very breath of God. Wind, breath, spirit. Blowing of a violent wind. Wind. The breath of God. In Genesis chapter 2, God breathed His Spirit. It's that word. Ruach, He breathed His Spirit into created humankind. The breath of God is what animates your soul. You are alive because the breath of God makes you unique and completely different than all of the rest of God's creation. You, made in the image of God, have the breath of God in you. I am filled with, you are. In Ezekiel, God breathed. Remember the story of the Valley of Dry Bones? God breathed on His people when they were dry and spiritually dead. And raised them to life. His breath, the wind. Paul says that we were dead in our trespasses and sins, and the Holy Spirit fills us with God's life. In order for the Holy Spirit to fill me with Himself, the wind, the breath, the life of God to fill me. See, when the Holy Spirit comes, the Holy Spirit wants to fill you up. But for God, the Holy Spirit, to do this, what does He have to do? I meant to have a glass of water up here as a simple illustration, but then I decided not to because I was thinking about spitting in it. And that'd be gross, wouldn't it? Because if I did that, it would illustrate my point, but it would just gross you out. But picture a glass of water that I put a little dirt in. Is that better? If it's dirty, I don't want to drink dirty water. Do you? I want to drink clean water. So what do I have to do if it's dirty? I have to clean it out, right? God the Holy Spirit, in order to fill me with Him, He who is pure and holy, has to clean me out. And that's what the Holy Spirit does. They saw what seemed to be tongues of fire that separated and came to rest on each of them. The fire symbolizes sanctification, purification, cleansing. Throughout the Bible, fire symbolizes purity. An angel in Isaiah chapter 6 took a live coal from the altar in front of God's throne, touched it to Isaiah's lips. In front of God's throne, at the altar of God, a coal that was holy, and he took it and he touched Isaiah's lips to purify him. A live coal, fire. To purify the prophet. The fire on the altar, the Bible says, sanctifies the sacrifices in the Old Testament. The sacrifices, each one of them, when they were burned in the fire, that sanctified, devoted, cleansed, purified them to God. The fire symbolized the fact that when the Holy Spirit fills us, He cleanses hearts. He cleanses our hearts of all of the damage and the effect that sinful human nature has done. See, the Bible says that when God created us as humans, Adam and Eve, He created us in His image, and He looked at them and He said, that's really good. Good, pure, right, untouched. But Adam and Eve chose to sin, and when they did, human nature, all of us inherited that nature that is twisted and damaged. And it is twisted and damaged and bent, the King James says, bent to point us toward an inclination to sin. And you say, I don't like that. Well, I agree with you. I don't like that either. But the proof is everywhere. I never taught either one of my children to sin. And I'm pretty sure Jan didn't either. We've been spending their whole lives trying to teach them to do right and live right and be right. And most of the people that I know, whether they're following Jesus or not, are working regularly to try to choose to do right things. And yet every person that you know, every person everywhere has chosen. The Bible says, for all have sinned. I don't have to convince anybody of that. We all know that we've done wrong things. And it is because the nature that we inherited has been twisted toward doing wrong things. God, the Holy Spirit, wants to free you from that compulsion to sin. Amen. It doesn't make it impossible to sin. It makes it possible not to sin. It makes it possible for us to choose. You today, in fact, I dirty dog double dare you. In the power of the Holy Spirit, you today can choose all day long not to do wrong. In the power of the Holy Spirit, by the power of the Spirit, I can walk like Jesus. By the power of the Spirit, I can choose today for my words and my thoughts and my actions to be focused on Jesus and His love. By the power of the Spirit today, I can choose to reject the temptation that I will face and embrace Jesus. Doesn't mean you become completely perfect. It doesn't mean that you become completely all-knowing. I'm not God, I'm just Alan. We can still make mistakes of every kind. We're limited. We're human beings. We're mortal. I'm not all-knowing. I'm not all-seeing. I'm not those things. That is God and God alone. We still have a lot of growing to do forward in our relationship with God. We can make all kinds of mistakes. We won't be perfect. But when God sanctifies your heart, He straightens out your heart. At Pentecost, the Holy Spirit filled the disciples and He sanctified their hearts. And then He gave them power. Christians, when we are filled with the Holy Spirit, He releases His power in us. And the power that I get most excited about initially is that power I have just been describing. The power to say no to sin and yes to righteousness. The power to be freed from the slavery to sin and to become a joy-filled, positive person in Christ Jesus. But that empowerment goes even further because we become empowered to be His witnesses. Jesus said that when you receive the Holy Spirit, you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and Judea and Samaria to the uttermost parts of the earth. Jesus wants us to be like Him. Well, our witness for Jesus is directly affected by our character, our integrity, the person that we are. When I say I'm a follower of Jesus, people look at me and say, that's what being a follower of Jesus looks like. And the more I look like Jesus, the more people say, you know, if that's what Jesus looks like, I want to be like Jesus. I want what you have. The more I am impacted by the character of Christ and I am transformed by the power of the Holy Spirit, the greater my witness is empowered by the Spirit for Jesus. We need the power of the Holy Spirit to turn our hearts in the right direction. And that's why I say the Holy Spirit gives Christians His strength. I was talking to a friend not long ago who is battling an addiction. He is a Christian. He is a committed Christian. He is a strong man. He is someone who wants very much to overcome the addiction that he has fallen into. But it has a hold of him and it is frustrating to him. And he said to me, Alan, I know I need the Holy Spirit now in my life more than I ever have. I need the Holy Spirit's power, His strength, to help me turn away from the temptation and to feed the fruit of the Spirit of Christ in my life. He said, I know the Spirit can help me to conquer the impossible. He said, I know. That doesn't mean I don't have to do my part. Of course I have to do my part. It means I need to be filled with the Spirit of God, and I need to allow Him to unleash His strength, His power in me. And it means for him, he needs to seek forgiveness and to try again. See, the Spirit of God is here right now, and He wants to help you to turn away from anything that would prevent you from being the person that God created you to be. God wants to give you His power and to make you whole. In 1 Peter 1:15, it says, just as He who called you is holy, speaking of God, so be holy in all you do. For it's written, be holy because I'm holy. Now, in both the Old Testament and the New Testament, the main word for holiness focuses on the idea of wholeness. God is whole. He is complete. God is without any kind of limitation, without any kind of incompleteness, without any kind of damage to His person or His character. And He wants to fill us with His Spirit and make us whole persons. He wants to help us to become the persons He created us to be. Not God, but like God. Sin has fractured our humanity. God wants to take our fragmented, incomplete human spirit and flood us with His Spirit to heal our brokenness and make us whole. And there we are. The obstacle to what God wants to do in each one of our lives is not music in the sanctuary or not your embarrassment for having your phone go off. The obstacle that every one of us faces, I'll just wait. The obstacle that we face is sin. Every time you say yes to sin, sin stains the space in your soul that God wants to fill. The thing that keeps people from experiencing the full God-given potential is sin. But the sin that we may struggle with, the sins of others, and the sin that is continually impacting the world that we live in, we need God. We need God this morning to send Pentecost in our lives. We need the power of the Holy Spirit to come and to cleanse and to fill and to empower each one of us. I don't know where you are in your spiritual journey today. It may be that you really need to just say, I choose Jesus. And if that's you this morning, blessed be the name. You need to come and you need to just choose Jesus today. But most of us here today have chosen Jesus and have been trying to follow Jesus. But many of us today recognize that struggle to say yes to God and no to sin, that ongoing difficulty there. And I'm here to tell you this morning, the Holy Spirit came to give you the power to live a whole and complete life for Him. Doesn't make it impossible to stumble or fall. It makes it possible to live today for Jesus. And if you're here today, Christian, and you are facing struggles that you cannot overcome, and you recognize that, and you want to go forward with Jesus, and you desire that, but you haven't been able to in your own strength, I'm telling you today, what you need is the fullness of the Holy Spirit in your life. Jesus said, God the Father wants to give you a gift, the gift of the Holy Spirit. And He said, just ask, just seek, just knock, just come, expecting that the Spirit of God wants to meet you where you are and do something amazing in your life to come and fill and cleanse and empower. So this morning, I want to ask you to stand with me, and I want to encourage you today, hear God's voice. Heed His voice. Listen to His voice. And just say, I want God's Spirit to do something in me today. Maybe you need Him to just refill your cup today. That's okay too. But the best place, the most important way that you can encounter the fullness of God, you can experience the response of God, is when you step out from where you are and you signify the decision to seek God by coming and kneeling and meeting God at this holy place. So as Pastor Jerry sings today, I want to encourage you, come. Just come. Come and let the Holy Spirit fill you up. Come right now. Don't wait. Just come and let God's Holy Spirit do something fresh and new and powerful and life-altering. Change the trajectory of the course of your nature. Just come today.
Come as wisdom to children. Come as new sight to the blind. Come, Lord, a strength to my weakness. Take me, soul, body, and mind. Come, Holy Spirit, I need
that our son graduated from high school. He was home for Christmas and we were so excited, and what he really wanted for Christmas was a bicycle. So Jan and I went out and we bought him a decent bicycle, and Jan had so much fun. She bought tons of wrapping paper and wrapped the thing completely in wrapping paper and set it there. And he came Christmas morning and there it was, and he unwrapped it. But then he lived in Oklahoma City at that point, and he decided the best way to get it there was just to return it to the store here and buy it at the store out there. And so we said okay, and we returned it. But 12 years later, he still hadn't bought another one. Now, we've encouraged him to over and over and over again. Sam, the money is there. We want to give you this gift. It's there. He has all kinds of reasons, good reasons, not. There's a gift waiting for him that he hasn't received. Now, I'm not trying to be critical of my son. I love and respect my son very, very much. And I'm not trying to be critical of you. I love and respect you very, very much. But God has a gift that he's waiting to give you, the gift of his Holy Spirit. All you have to do is come. Come and ask. And his promise is you can receive the fullness of the Holy Spirit in your life. So Jerry's going to sing one more time. And while he does, this is for you. There's a gift waiting. Just come while he sings.
Come as a rest to the weary. Come as new balm for the soul. With joy evermore. Come, Holy Spirit, I need you. Come, sweet Spirit, I pray. Come in your strength and your power.
you, Lord, so much today. Thank you for your presence. Oh, God, thank you so much for how very real and how very clear your presence is right here, right now with us. Thank you, God, for how you're working in so many of our hearts and lives today. How clearly and powerfully you are touching so many of our hearts and lives today. We're so grateful, Holy Spirit, for your presence, for your work in us. And we pray, Lord, that you would continue to work deeply and powerfully, answer every prayer, hear the cry of every hungry heart, break the power of every restriction on someone who wants to move closer to you. Come, Holy Spirit, and move in your people and empower us today to live holy lives, to be your witnesses, to bless the world that we're a part of. Thank you. Thank you, thank you, God, for how you are at work among us today. Please continue that work as we go from this place today. In your presence, Holy Spirit, we pray. Amen. God bless you all. Thanks for being here.